Hyperion Audiobooks presents, Are You Ready to Succeed? Unconventional Strategies for Achieving Personal Mastery in Business and Life by Srikumar S. Rao, read by the author.
What if I were to tell you that you live in a dream world and that you have always been living in a dream world, that you have never known anything but this dream world? What if I were to go on and explain that you, who have spent your whole life so carefully constructing this world, have put a great deal of stuff in it that you don't really like? Things that cause you to moan and groan, sometimes very loudly indeed. If you are like most people, you will think, nonsense. This is no fantasy, it's my life. I understand that it's hard to accept that your reality is but a shadow, and one that you created. Instead, it's easier to dismiss what I say and persist in thinking that what you recognize as your life is real and that it somehow simply happened. You had nothing or very little to do with it. And that, I am here to tell you, is the source, the root cause of all of your problems. Knowing that you're living in a dream world is actually very liberating because it gives you the option of waking up. I sincerely hope that you are ready to do so. If you're not yet ready to do so, you have another option. You can at least create a new, better dream world. Regardless of whether you wake up or create a better dream world, you will find that life has become richer. The colors you see are more vibrant, your interactions with others are more fulfilling, and you experience more joyous moments. You become more effective at work and enjoy it more. I know this is so because it happened to me and because I have helped hundreds of others get there. 3 decades ago, when I entered the workforce, I could have sworn that the world consisted of 2 sets of people. Those who passionately loathed their jobs and those who simply disliked them. As for me, I busily alternated between the two. It wasn't fun, but I didn't know that anything else existed. The notion that one could find deep meaning and sustenance from life and from what one did for a living was an alien one. Searching to quell my dissatisfaction, after a few years, I left private enterprise and took a position in academe. It gradually dawned on me that I was hardly alone in my unhappiness. As I spoke to thousands of undergraduates, graduate students, doctoral candidates, and corporate managers, I saw that most could readily identify with my feelings of angst and ennui, and many had tales of their own. I knew there had to be a better way. Life was not meant to be like this. If I felt trapped, then so must thousands of others with whom I had spoken, and, by extension, millions of others in the broader world. I was so busy wallowing in my own misery, I barely noticed that there were some free spirits who had escaped my fate and who soared effortlessly over the quicksand that kept sucking me in. It was not until much later that I realized they were the real teachers and the ones worth emulating. During this period, the one truly bright spot in my life was reading. I had been a voracious reader all my life, particularly philosophy, spiritual biography, and mystical autobiography from many different times and traditions. The stories and their wisdom gave me my only sense of hope that there was something powerful, meaningful, and good at work in the universe. Immersed in these books, I would feel the peace and the ineffable sense of well-being I sought. But the mundane demands of the world would inevitably come creeping back, and they were wonderfully effective at suffocating the freedom I experienced during such reading. I felt like the water buffaloes that, during hot summer days in tropical countries, like to wallow in the muddy water. It keeps off the flies and mosquitoes and other biting insects that cover the backs of the buffaloes like a blanket. When the pain gets too intense, the buffalo dives into the water and experiences blessed relief. The insects rise off its back in a swarm, but they hover in the air. They know the buffalo will surface soon, and the moment it does, they will descend and continue their feeding. It was a perfect visual metaphor for the way I felt. The insects, the gnawing insecurities, worries, anxieties, jealousies, irritations, concerns, fears, guilt, and apprehensions, kept coming back. And each time they returned, they seemed stronger and more fearsome. Gradually, I came to realize that my life need not be like this. My mental insects could be banished, and relatively easily. I could submerge like the buffalo, but I did not have to surface at the same spot. I could swim 100 feet underwater and emerge in a spot clear of pests. The pests will come back, but the process can easily be repeated. Freedom is possible. I began to think about the toll this pestilence was taking on the students. After all, these were men and women destined to be leaders in business. It was clear to me that students were focusing on the wrong things. They were far too fixated on money, power, and prestige. They evaluated opportunities based on what they could get out of them. Many were prepared to make incredible sacrifices, to work hellish hours in order to make it. But the price they paid was far too high. I knew I could help them achieve better results with far less anguish by teaching them a series of simple switches in the way they approached life, such as by focusing on what they could contribute rather than what they could get. I devised a course to help these students achieve a breakthrough in their lives, one that would enable them to be true leaders. On the surface, the syllabus had nothing to do with traditional business principles. I was unsure if anyone would be interested in something that wouldn't immediately lead to a business specialty. After all, most of the students I encountered were so goal-directed that they were like the young man in the parable who banged on the door of the master. "I want to be enlightened," he gasped, when the master answered. "If I stay as your disciple, how long will it take?" The master surveyed the young man. He had a strong physique, and the inner restlessness that drove him was almost palpable. A good candidate. 10 years, said the master. The youth wilted, as if struck with an axe. For a few minutes he stood with head bowed. Then he looked up. "If I work night and day," he asked fiercely, "if I do without sleep and do twice what your other disciples do, then how long will it take for me to become enlightened?" 20 years, said the master calmly. So perplexed was the youth, and so earnest his demeanor, that the sage relented and explained, "When you have one eye so firmly fixed on the goal, you have but one eye left to find the way." I firmly believed that until the students found their way, they would never be able to live powerful lives, personally or professionally. I created the course that became Creativity and Personal Mastery. From the very beginning, I envisaged all those associated with the course, the students, guest speakers, teaching assistants, etc., as a community. I intended it to be a source of ongoing support and inspiration. This worked. The bonds formed are deep and frequently span generations. The course was designed not to have an end. Students embarked on a journey of exploration and growth that was expected to last decades, even a lifetime. Here are some of the transformative experiences reported. Depression being replaced with deep-seated optimism and joy. Warm relations developing with an estranged parent. Changes in career path in line with innate interest.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.